I am grateful to be with you today. The distinction is, if you weren't here last week, I was, because I can join you by video. So, apparently my jokes got rougher over the weekend. I know, that wasn't really a joke, so my bad. It's great to be back. So we have a baby. He's a boy, which was confirmation that he was a boy. He sleeps, so all's well. So today, we're talking about this idea, we're talking about the ultimate trust fall. And I really got this idea first. So years ago, we took a group of teenagers to a camp, and the speaker got up there and he was talking about what it looks like to follow God, which is the essence of our faith. It's not just a decision that is made one time, but it's this ongoing choice to follow Christ in everything that we do. So he's talking about what it looks like to follow God. And he said, following God is like a trust fall. Out of curiosity, how many of you have ever been a part of something or done a trust fall? Some? Okay. Do I need like an illustration? Like, are we... Okay, that's a guess. Aaron, you're there somewhere. I saw you because you jumped out. Yeah, I figured would you come up here real quickly? I don't have to tell him to do anything quickly. He's going to do it quickly. So good. So yeah, just keep going. Would you give Aaron an applause? Megan, Aaron's here. So Aaron's familiar with trust fall. So right, do you want to trust fall or do you want me to trust fall?
You trust fall.
I shouldn't have offered that as a... Okay, so trust fall is this, I really trust you, right? And he survived the Maysville Filthy 5K. So I can, yeah, so he's... Not too far. Oh, I put my leg back. All right, I can do better. All right, ready? I won't put my leg back. Oh, thank you so much for catching me. All right, you can go back. Give him a round of applause. I didn't really think he was going to let his pastor fall on the stage in front of everybody. But it's still kind of scary. So the speaker was talking about, following God is like a trust fall. And you just kind of have to let go and trust God. And then this is back when I was a youth pastor, my teenagers, who were just morons, like wonderful morons, but they were morons, they started doing that throughout the rest of the week. Except they would do it like spontaneously. And so it wasn't like, come up here, all right, you're gonna catch me, right? Okay, be sure. And then fall back. Like they would just start falling all over the camp and they'd just like walk up to somebody like, trust fall, and go back. And then like they were doing it so much, like at first when it's a new thing, you know how like your brain is more like sensing of new things and things that stick out. But then it kind of just became so common that I don't think people's brains were picking it out when it was happening. And so, like, they just started falling. And, like, people weren't catching them. And some kids were getting really hurt. And so we had to say, like, okay, following Jesus is no longer like a trust fall. we just can't do that anymore. And here was the distinction that I thought was interesting in how the speaker understood it. Is this is how he would have defined trust, especially in terms of faith. That trust is following God into the unknown. Which is, for a lot of us, how we would define trust when it comes to our faith. And it's kind of like, I don't know my next step. I don't know my next decision. I don't know what to do here in this relationship. I don't know what it looks like forward. And some people will just come around and be like, well, you just need to have faith. You just need to trust God that he'll take care of it. Even though you don't know, you know that God knows. God only gives you the next step. God knows the whole path. But you just need to follow in the next step. Which is all like, that's all absolutely correct. It is. Every single bit of that is correct. But I think it neglects a really important part of trust that we don't touch on enough, and that's this side of trust. That trust is following God's instructions. And that's a big difference between simply saying, I don't know the future, but I know the one who holds the future, and so I'm going to trust and pray moving forward that God will take care of me and God will work things out, versus going, God has spoken clearly on these issues, and all I actually need to do is to see it and to walk into it. This is an element of trust. The idea that, hey, God's will, God's desires for my life, he's already mapped out for me. He's already told me hey, this is how I approach this. All I need to do is just obey. All I need to do is just more so fall into step with where God's already going. And so that's the side of trust that we're going to talk about today. Not following God into the unknown, but what it looks like to actually follow God's instructions. And we're going to talk about it in a specific area because trust, faith, following is kind of this lofty idea. But I think it's important that we actually make it practical at times and understand how it applies to our daily lives. We're going to talk about it in terms of the area of provision, of the ways in which God provides for us continuously. And normally when we talk about provision, provision is stuff, right? Provision is money or things that I need. But we're going to broaden the idea of provision. And we're going to talk about it in three areas. In terms of ability, identity, and security. So this is what I'm going to ask. When you came in, you got a piece of paper. Go ahead. Get out your piece of paper. Good. This is good. And I want you to take a second, and I'll kind of talk through it as you do this. And it doesn't have to make sense now, okay? So if you go, I have no idea where you're going with this, that's okay. I'm perfectly fine with it. You'll know at the end. I hope. But I want you to write down when I say these words of your ability or your identity or your security, what comes to mind? So I want you to go ahead right now and write those down on the paper. What is my ability? What is my identity? And what do I take security in? Some of you are looking at each other blankly. This is a good sign. It makes me feel like things are going well. As you go, let me share it like this. For me, my faith is not in my personal belongings. My faith is far more often, if a problem comes up, I'll say, oh, I can solve that. In that moment, if I am realizing that that is God who's given me abilities, it is an act of faith. It is an act of trust. If I don't, then I'm just on my own. For my reputation, for the person who I kind of claim myself as, for who I want other people to see me, I often view that is self-made. That is something that I did myself, instead of God putting me in position. And then insecurity is simply the things that we know we can fall back on. Sometimes this is financial. Sometimes this is relational, that I know, hey, if something goes wrong, I know that they'll be there to catch me. I know that this person will be there. And these are far more often, rather than just simply things, these are the things that we find that we're actually trusting in. So I just want you, as we're going throughout this, I want you to have that on your paper in front of you as I keep talking. If something comes to your mind, feel free to write it down, and then we'll do something with that at the end. I realized our tendency when it comes to provision, we have two kind of tensions that we'll fill into. And I realized the first one from a conversation that my parents had, and that's the tendency to over-spiritualize provision. And what happened was, so I may have told this story once before. I was in high school, and my dad and I, we were downstairs, and we're watching college football. And my dad had a big screen TV back when not all TVs were big screen TVs, because that like used to be a thing. Now people are like, I'm getting a TV, and you're just like, oh, it's going to be an enormous TV, because all TVs are enormous TVs now. But it was like the one that like had like the speaker in front, and it took like 12 people to move, and it was like, it was a big deal. So we're sitting downstairs, and we're watching college football, and we're just kind of laying around, and my dad says, I love this TV. Which you should never say. Like, just don't say it. He goes, I love this TV, and I look up, and I went, me too, Dad. Me too. So we're watching the game, and about 10 minutes later, the TV goes out. Like, you just see, like, psh, the line. And my mom is downstairs with us. She was kind of working on the computer behind us. And my dad just goes, oh, no. And so he hurries up and goes over and gets the warranty, because he's the kind of person who's got all the warranties right there. And it was, like, 3 days beyond the warranty. And so he's just like, oh, no. And my mom goes, maybe this this is a sign. And my dad, in one of his most brilliant responses ever, he goes, I agree. It's a sign we need a new TV. which we ended up getting, which was fantastic. So, but I think there's that tendency that we take areas of faith, areas of provision, and we over-spiritualize everything, and every single thing is a sign. And we actually saw this a couple years ago when in the NFC Championship game, the Seahawks played the Packers, and the Seahawks ended up winning in this thrilling game. And Russell Wilson, the quarterback for the Seahawks afterwards, he's like, oh, that's God. God set it up to make it dramatic. God set it up to make it that much more special. And the next day, the Packers quarterback, Aaron Rodgers, he was on a radio show, and he was asked about Russell Wilson's comments. And this is what Aaron Rodgers said. He said, I don't think God cares a whole lot about the outcomes. He cares about the people involved, but I don't think he's a big football fan. I don't think God's a big football fan. And I think that's important because there will be a tendency for every single thing that comes along to go, oh, it's God, oh, it's God. And there is a danger to that, okay? And I want to show you a couple of them real quick, and then we'll talk about the other side of under-spiritualizing provision. So the first danger to over-spiritualizing provision is we abandon responsibility. We abandon responsibility. Let's say this scenario. Teachers, you'll get this quickly. People who have kids in school, you'll feel this as well, especially. Let's say you're a teacher, you wake up one morning, you're not feeling great. You're not feeling well enough to go into school. And I know it's got to be really bad, because some of you teachers, you're like hacking and coughing on the way in, and you still power through it, so good for you. You should maybe get more rest, but I'll leave that to you. So, but like, you're like really feeling bad. What do you do? Well, I don't know the exact procedure because I'm not a teacher, so I'll assume this is how it goes. You call or you tell someone what's going on, you maybe make plans, and they will get a substitute to fill into your room, right? Something along those lines that at least ends up with another person is manning your class for that day. Let me tell you what you don't do. You don't go, well, I guess God just wants my class to be by themselves today. I guess this is a sign from God that he wants those 20 kindergartners to fend for themselves, right? Like, we don't do that, do we? And so when we do that, when we over-spiritualize provision, we'll have a tendency to abandon responsibility because every single thing is something God is doing. Another side of it is we'll have a tendency to lose wisdom. Within the abandoning responsibility, we'll lose wisdom. So when I was, I think it was my sophomore year, maybe junior year in high school, I worked for a moving company for the summer, which was a horrible, horrible job. I was way too skinny and light to have that job, but they gave it to me anyway. And so within the job, they had us, they had drivers and then helpers, not a driver, obviously. So they had all of us helpers just kind of sit in a room, and the drivers would come in and they would pick which helpers they wanted to go with them on the job. And so you realized, well, I'll say this, I realized it later on. But like, I'd come in and I didn't really want to work. I was there because my parents made me get a job, and so I didn't really want to work. And so I'd show up like right at the time that I had to be there when almost everyone was there. And I rarely got picked. And so like when the driver didn't pick you, it was like, oh, okay, I go back to bed. This is the best day of work I've ever had in my life. Thank you so much. Now, I didn't get paid, but that's kind of how I took it. I didn't go, this is important, I didn't go, well, I guess God didn't want me to work today. I guess God really felt I needed the rest, because I did not, I assure you. This is what my friend, who really needed the money and needed the job, did. We had to be there at 7:15, so I was there at 7:15. He was there at 6:30, and he was figuring out the driver's routes and what they needed to do. And so he was sitting right up front, ready to go. And when some of the drivers would come in, he says, hey, I know where that is. I can help you with that. And he got picked almost every single day. Now, if we both would have just gone, like, he learned a lesson. He gained wisdom on to how to get a job and how to actually get paid. For me, I didn't care. But if we both would have taken that position of, well, I guess God's just picking who's getting working, who's working today, then there would have been some serious wisdom lost. Now, for me, on my part, no wisdom gained anyway, so that didn't really matter. The third side of it, if we over-spiritualize provision, is it can set ourselves up for a crisis of faith. And this is when you get into those moments where something bad happens, and you're just going, why, God? Why? And it doesn't have to be something, like, huge. It could be like you ordered a quarter pounder and they gave you a Big Mac, and you're, why, God? Why? But this is what it says in Matthew 5:45. It says, he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. And I think if we take everything as this divine sign, we can set ourselves up for a crisis of faith. That we need to understand sometimes things that are inconvenient, things that don't go great, sometimes they just happen. Sometimes we need to take responsibility for that. Sometimes we need to gain wisdom from those situations. But when we just take every single thing that comes relates to our ability, our identity, or our security, and we just go, well, it's just God, we neglect how God actually set everything up, that he partners with us. And so I think it's important that we understand that. Now, the other side of it is, that's over-spiritualizing provision. Is I think we also have a tendency to under-spiritualize provision. And we take the areas in which God's provided and we never look to him. And I think this happens far more often, if I can say it like this, we'll always have a tendency to over-spiritualize provision when things go wrong, and a tendency to under-spiritualize it when things go well. Because when things go wrong, it's God's fault. When things go well, we're thrilled. And we don't really care. We just move on. But whether things are going good or bad within our individual lives, there is a real danger to never looking to God and to never understanding how God is acting and working. And that's where I want to spend the bulk of our time today. So if you have your Bible with you, open up to Exodus chapter 16. Exodus 16 is where we're going to be today. And we're going to look at this passage. I'm going to make a few points as we go. It's kind of split into three different sections. You'll see that as we move through it. But I want to look at this passage for just one purpose, to see how God wants us to see the arena of provision. Because within this passage, God shows us real clearly, like when it comes to your ability, identity, security, when it comes to the things you need, to the things that you want, this is how you should see what's taking place. And so the setup for the story is the Israelite people have been in slavery for 400 years. And through these miraculous things, Moses comes. Moses is God's messenger. And he comes and he gets Pharaoh, the leader of Egypt's, attention, and basically forces his hand to release the people from slavery. And we see incredible things. We see the Red Sea's parted. They walk through, crashes down then on the Egyptian army. And so, like, all these people have seen these incredible things that God does. And then they go into the desert. And they get into the desert, and literally the first thing we see is they go, we're hungry. traveling with the Israelites is equivalent to taking any trip with a toddler. That's what I've realized. Like, they see God work all these amazing things, then they get into the desert. First thing, we're hungry. What are we going to do? And so this is how the story takes place. Exodus 16, starting in verse 1. It says, the whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin. That's a bad omen. Which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, if only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There, we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death. Now, pause right here, just to be clear. Like, they were slaves. Like, that's where they were. But there's two key things that I want to acknowledge, just for us to be mindful of in their attitude, and we see it in two words. The first one is there. They say, there, we sat around pots of meat. So the first thing that they have a tendency to do when provision is lacking is to compare. It's amazing how quickly jealousy can rise up when we begin looking at what everyone else around us has compared to what we have. And so that's the first thing they do. They go, hey, it was better back then. And so this may be a previous period of your life for someone else. And then the second word that's key is right here. It says, but you. And so they blame. They compare. And then they blame. They say, hey, this is your fault. This is your problem. And then we see something important happens. This is verse 4. It says, then the Lord said to Moses, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. Those are very important phrases right there. He says, so in this arena, what is at stake is I am going to test them. So the importance of provision, we should understand, is to be seen as a test from God. How we handle the things that have been entrusted to us, the things that we are capable of, and the things that we take security in, should be seen not just as, oh, I'm so grateful, or oh, I did this on my own, okay? It should be seen as this is a test from God as to whether or not we will follow His instructions. So important. Then the next thing, we're going to jump down to verse 6. God shows us what's at stake. So it says this, and Moses and Aaron emphasize it as well. It says, so Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, in the evening you will know. Important phrase. In the evening you will know, and it says that it was the Lord. You will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. And in the morning you will see the glory of the Lord because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we that you should grumble against us? Moses also said, you will know that it was the Lord. So again, we see, you will know that it was the Lord when he gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we? You are not grumbling against us, but against the Lord. Then Moses told Aaron, say to the entire Israelite community, come before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling. While Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, they looked toward the desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in the cloud. The Lord said to Moses, I have heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them, at twilight you will eat meat, and in the morning you will be filled with bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God. So in case we didn't get it, we see Aaron says it, Moses says it, and then God himself says it. He says, hey, here's the deal. I'm going to provide. But I'm not just providing so that you will be provided for. I am providing so you will know that I'm God. And I think this gets into one of those elements of faith that I could talk about for a really long time, but I'm going to try to restrict myself to just like a minute or two. We have such a tendency to look at the thing. But for God, the thing always points to something else. Like we say it like this. We see biblically that greed is a sin. Greed is a sin. Why is greed a sin? We would just go, well, greed's bad. No. Greed is a failure to trust God that he'll take care of us. Biblically, we see that like disobedience is a sin. Why is disobedience a sin? We go, because disobedience is bad. No. Disobedience is putting ourselves on the throne instead of God and putting ourselves in the decision-making seat. And so there's always something behind it that is even more significant and more important. And so we go in the area of provision, in the area of what we are asking God to provide for us. Why is this such a big deal? And we would look at it and we would go, because we need it. Right? We'd say, I need this job or this relationship or the light to turn green because I'm already late. Like, we would look at those things like, please God, come on, I need this to work. And what God is saying here is he's going, okay, I'm going to provide. You're hungry? That's important. I'm going to provide. But the reason why I'm going to provide is not just so that you will be provided for. It's so that you'll know that I'm God. That it has a far greater scope to it. There's a far greater importance of what's going on. And so we'll say it like this this morning. That our trust in God's provision shows we can trust God for salvation. Our trust in the things that we are asking God to provide for shows, and the ones that he comes through and he says, yes, yes, I'll provide, shows us the reason why it's there is so that we'll know clearly, hey, I can trust God for far bigger things than this. I can trust God for eternity. Because that's a really hard thing, isn't it? Like, I don't know about you, for me, and I understand we all have different backgrounds, for me, I grew up in church. Like, that's my whole life. And when I was a kid, like, I prayed a prayer with my parents that was a prayer like this. Like, God, I trust you. I ask forgiveness for my sins, and I want to spend eternity with you in heaven. Now, my parents had to pray it first, and I followed because I didn't know what I was really getting into, but I believed it. And people told me in that moment, we use different language, we use the language of follow, but people told me in that moment that I was saved. And I can't tell you how many times since then I've wondered if I actually was. Like, how many times since then? Because there was nothing that happened. I prayed a prayer, I said amen, and then when I was a teenager, I was like, oh, I messed up. Am I still saved? I don't know. Better pray it again just to be sure. And this is a common conversation we have in regards to baptism. That it's a matter of, oh, I was baptized before, but I did this since then. It was like, no, it still took. You're good. You don't have to get back in the water every single time you mess up, every single time you sin. We can trust God for our salvation regardless of our unfaithfulness. And the reason why we have all these other things in between is to continuously point us back to him. Say, oh yeah, I know I can trust you. I know I can trust you. And then the story gets really good. This is my favorite part. So this is verse 13. It says, that evening, quail came and covered the camp. Quail's bird. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, what is it? For they did not know what it was. Now, pause right here real quick. A little bit of audience participation, if that's okay. I know it's dark, but I know you're still out there because I can hear you sniffling from time to time. Okay? Does anyone know what the bread was called? Thank you for the murmurs at first, and then we got enough courage from the crowd as a whole. Said, yeah, manna. So it's called manna. The title, if like you actually had your Bible, you could like see the title. It says manna and quail. We've already seen the quail, so you could trust from context clues that this next one is manna. So we call it manna. The word manna means, what is it? Isn't that great? So like literally, that's the definition. If you say it's manna, what you're saying is, what is it? Now, I don't necessarily think you should start using that in everyday language. Like, I have something in my hand. Manna. Like, it'd just be really confusing to everybody. But look at this interchange, because I think this is so important. So they say, what is it? For they did not know what it was. And then it says this. Moses said to them, it is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. Now, they still call it, what is it? But look at this distinction, because I think this is absolutely massive. While they're asking what is before them, Moses' answer is that it's God who has provided. And I think it is so important that they still don't actually name the bread something in particular, that the name of the bread is still, what is it? And that's okay. Because they don't need to know fully what it was, because they already know who has provided it for them. This is where it really hits us. Our tendency is anytime we have want, need, or desire to fix every single bit of our attention on what needs to happen. But Moses switches the answer. He doesn't answer what it is. He never names it. He goes, no, no, God provided. God provided. When we're looking at the what, Moses responds, no, no, you should be looking at the who. But when we're looking at the thing, Moses directs us very clearly, no, no, it is the person that you are looking toward. It is God who you need to fix your attention on. And so this is how I see it, that when we see provision correctly, our what questions are answered with a who. Our prayers that we continuously pray, we go, God, I need this. God, I want this. God, please come through in this way. Whether it's like these big things, big life decisions, or these small moments, we understand when we see provision correctly, we're not praying for a what. We're praying to a who. We're looking to someone, not for something in particular. And this changes everything. Because whenever you pray for that thing and then it doesn't come, what do we think? God let me down. He must not be there. But what's happening in the moment is God is teaching us over and over again to rely and to trust on Him when we begin to see the arena of provision correctly. Now, there's a reason why Moses is the one leading this. Because in a sense, and he still has struggles, but in a sense, Moses had already passed the provision test, which is why he's the one leading the people. So we see at the very beginning, whenever Moses kind of first receives his call to lead the people out of Egypt, he's before God in this incredible moment. And the words that God speaks to him is this. He says, Moses, what is in your hand? And Moses was a shepherd, and so he looks at his hand and he says, a staff. A staff. Now, this is important, because Moses' staff is, in a sense, one of the central characters of the book of Exodus. We see when Moses raises his staff, it causes locusts to come all over Egypt, which was meant to help the people be freed from slavery. We see his staff, when raised up, parts the Red Sea into two. And when his staff, when raised down, caused the waters to come back together. We see over and over that his staff caused hail to come on the ground. And so like one of the central figures of the book of Exodus is Moses' staff and its presence and its significance. But the reason why Moses had his staff is because he was a shepherd. And so in this moment when he comes before God, God says to him, Moses, what is in your hand? And he says, a staff. Now this is huge, because Moses' staff in his day would have represented three things: his ability, his identity, and his security. It would have been how he did his job. It would have marked him to other people as a shepherd. And it would have been how he protected himself. And in this moment before God, after God says, what is in your hand? His directions are very clear. He says, throw it on the ground. And Moses does. Now he eventually calls him to pick it back up. But it's within this distinct moment that God asks him to lay down everything that he saw as his provision. To take his ability, his identity, and his security, and to lay it down before God. And God said, if you're willing to lay it down before me, then I can trust you with this great task, and you can pick it back up again. But you need to know clearly that it's mine, and I'm going to use it. And it's this distinction that is so important for us to see, that I think it is so easy at times to see the things that have been given to us or the things that have been entrusted to us as ours And as a result, we defend and we fight and we hold them with closed fists because we can't handle the idea of them not being there. And God says, no, the reason why it's there is so that you'll look to me. The reason why you have it is so that you will understand that I can be trusted with things far greater than this. And if you would only be willing to lay it down before me, then I can use it to do far more than you can possibly imagine. And pray for us. Father, I know personally, it is easy for me to see the things that I believe and that I mistaken think I have, to see the things that I claim as mine, possessions, people, skills that I've developed, reputation. How easy it is for me to claim these as my own. And when I do, I am ungrateful. I am jealous. And as a result, I am unfaithful with what you have entrusted me with. And so, Father, in this moment, for me, help me to see everything I have as yours anyway. Help me to understand. Help me to see clearly that you are the one who is the giver of gifts. That you are the one who bestows these blessings upon us. And that it was never mine to begin with. And so who am I to claim it as my own? Help me to be grateful. Father, as a result, I ask that you would help us to see the things that we claim as ours, how you see them, that we would see these things within our lives as yours, and that we would give thanks, and that we would see you for how great you truly are as a result of. I pray this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen.